In the spirit of new beginnings and a new year, let us combine the words and thoughts of several key poets. And first we begin with Rumi. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving. In that spirit, I must say shalom, assalamu alaikum, good morning and bright blessings to all. And on this particular Sunday, I also offer you an invitation by the poet Mary Oliver, who passed away quite recently. And it's a poem entitled Invitation. Oh, do you have time to linger for just a little while out of your busy and very important day for the goldfinches that have gathered in a field of thistles for a musical battle to see who can sing the highest note or the lowest or the most expressive of mirth or the most tender? Their strong, blunt beaks drink the air as they strive melodiously, not for your sake and not for mine, and not for the sake of winning, but for sheer delight and gratitude. Believe us, they say, it is a serious thing just to be alive on this fresh morning in the broken world. I beg of you, do not walk by without pausing to attend to this rather ridiculous performance. It could mean something. It could mean everything. It could be what Rilke meant when he wrote, "You must change your life." Today's service is very special. I am very pleased to invite to co-lead with me Dr. Maryam Mostoufi. She lived in, is it Azawaz, Iran, from 1972 to 79, where she worked as director of the English program for medical students at a medical school. And she holds a Master of Arts degree in Human Resource Development from the University of Illinois at Springfield and a Doctorate of Ministry from the Ecumenical Theological Seminary in Detroit. And until her retirement, she was Chief of the Developmental Disabilities Bureau Best Practices within the Illinois Department of Human Services. And there she had the responsibility for the development and implementation of staff training programs for individuals providing services and supports in both public and private settings to thousands of people. Dr. Mostoufi, my friend, also completed a two-year-long psychosocial care chaplaincy internship with the Memorial Medical Center and also SIU School of Medicine. As a result, she was the first Muslim woman to be admitted to the Association of Professional Chaplains. She is a chaplain to area Muslims and has served on the boards of various Springfield organizations, including but not limited to the Greater Springfield Interfaith Association, where she has just completed a two-year tenure as president, Helping Hands Homeless Shelter, and the Coalition to Promote Human Dignity and Diversity. And she's also been a spokesperson for the Islamic Society of Greater Springfield. Without further ado, and she has many more accomplishments, I'll mention that she was recently nominated for the Copley Award, and which is a great honor, but.
Thank you very much. This is not my first time here. Some of you are beginning probably to think that I'm a member because I'm here at least once a year and I enjoy coming and seeing old faces and new ones alike. I can remember when I first started coming here to the UU congregation, it wasn't actually here. It was at the church on MacArthur. And there were only a handful of people. And I look out now and I'm impressed to see how much your congregation has grown. What I'd like to do now is ask all of the youth, all of the children in our congregation that are comfortable to come forward and just sit up here on the floor with me if they will, please. I'm going to give you the greetings of peace that we say in Arabic, which is salam. Can you repeat that? Salam. Do you know what that means? It means peace. And that's something that we all, as children and adults, are looking for in our lives. And one of the ways that we begin to develop a sense of peace within our hearts and peace among other people is to stop every day and maybe talk to our higher power. Some might call that God. Some might hear that as an internal voice. You might say Almighty or all that is holy. That is a name that you may give to this being that you speak to. But there are many different ways in which you do that. You can do it silently. You can do that with using your voice. But along with that, we oftentimes see that people have various postures that they use to help them get centered for their time of speaking to their holy power, okay? And sometimes, and if you'll do this with me, sometimes they hold their hands like this. Can you hold your hands like this? Very good. See how we do that? Sometimes people fold their hands like this. Or maybe they hold their hands out. Good. Or maybe they hold them up, or maybe out even like this. And some will be on their knees. Can you go onto your knees? I can't do that, but oh, look at all of you. Good. How many of you can do that? I certainly couldn't do it that fast. We'd be spending the rest of the time, Mike, trying to get to that position. Okay. Some do it when they're on their knees, and they may put their hands in front of them too when they do it. Some people are going to do it leaning forward and touching their head on the ground and putting their hands to the side of their head. Can you lean forward and touch your head and put your hand? Look at this. Wow, this is impressive. You follow directions wonderfully. Okay, you can sit back up. Okay. Some people do it with dancing. Can you stand up? And they do that by twirling around and around and around. Can you twirl around? Look at this. And they do that. Isn't that fun? Is that the way you're going to pray next time, huh? You're going to do that twirling around. Yeah, I imagine. Especially for some of us that don't like to sit still, the twirling is a lot of fun. And sometimes we do it with our eyes closed, and sometimes we do it with our eyes open. There are many different ways that we, and I'm going to use the word pray, there are many different ways that we can pray or talk to our higher power. Are any of them wrong? No. Are all of them right? Exactly. And that's one thing that we should learn, is that they are all right. And as they help us develop that sense of peace in our heart, we hope that it helps us develop a sense of peace among other people as well. And then we can have a peaceful world. Thank you very much for participating today. Go in peace to your classes.
He is going to play Melody Elegy by Jules Massenet, which was a favorite song of our deceased member Wes Geisler, who is dear to my heart.
Thank you.
shared silence during?
During the silence, I would like you to reach back and try to recall the first time, the first moment you had an interfaith experience where you encountered someone from a different faith tradition. So please do that. Every faith leader is, in essence, a storyteller. Those of us who have a voice might even be a story singer. And so imagine, if you will, in a house of worship or a community, various songs being lifted up, and sometimes they come together and they converge, like all the candles that we lit on Christmas Eve, and it forms a symphony, a litany of color, a brightness, a tapestry of faith, if you will. And I would offer you an insight by Erasmus of Rotterdam, an early Christian humanist. And he said, if you would know another's opinion, you must first know the language in which that opinion is expressed. And if that sentiment is true, how much more true to understand another person's spirituality, their pathway of being in this world? Rumi said, all religions, all this singing, there is one song. The differences are just illusion and vanity. The sunlight looks a little different on this wall than it does on that wall, and a lot different on this other one. But it's all still one light. And so we come together in the spirit of conversation, not of conversion. And when we do that, whether in this context or others, oh, the places you will go.
I would also like to share that Karen Armstrong once said, to understand your own faith, you need to study that of others.
I remember my first interfaith moment. I was a child. It was the 60s. I had listened to some songs written by George Harrison and later by the Beatles at large, lifting up anthems of hope, celebrating Hinduism, for example, or a vision of other religions weaving together into a Western sensibility. My teachers were also listening to those same songs. And for me, as a young Catholic boy in the era of Vatican II, our teachers inspired us to get up, to form circles, to sing and dance together, songs in particular from the Jewish tradition. And then we had a field trip to a synagogue where we peppered the unfortunate rabbi with all the questions that were bubbling through our imagination. That was my first interfaith experience.
My first interfaith experience actually occurred in the church I was raised in, the Disciple of Christ Church in Marshalltown, Iowa. And we began by learning about the synagogue across the street from us. This little small town of 20,000 still had its own synagogue. And the rabbi and our minister became very close friends. And they would argue scriptural points from time to time. And one time, I'm not sure which one did it, but one of them got a goat in reference to a scripture that they had been disputing and put it in the car of the other one, a live goat. This wasn't any stuffed animal. They also had fun teasing each other, teasing the church secretary. She had gotten a new chair and she was rather short, so they put a foam cushion on top of it so that she could reach the desk. And she complained every day when she would come to work that that cushion drew water because it was always moist. It was because they were pouring water on that cushion from time to time. They also, through their friendship, developed a friendship that allowed them to stand with one another in times of grief. One Thanksgiving, the rabbi's two children were coming home from college and were killed in a car accident. I still remember standing with that congregation. That's friendship. And it takes time. It takes opportunity for us to recognize that we need to be relational and look beyond what each other's faith is and learn from it and recognize that we are all one, created by the same being.
I love to read. Perhaps some of you love to read as well. And beginning in high school, I began an exploration through Houston Smith, The Religions of the World, and the Portable World Bible. I was assigned to read Black Elk Speaks and gained an appreciation for Native Americans, quite unlike what we witnessed this weekend in Washington, D.C., Catholic boys taunting indigenous leaders. I visited a meeting of the Unification Church when that was first becoming quite prominent in the news, the Church of the Reverend Sung Young Moon. And I studied them and wrote a report for my class. But it really wasn't until I entered Divinity School in a very mixed, diverse classroom when we picked up our books and we read the scriptures of Abraham in Christian context, in Jewish, and in Muslim. And one Muslim student interrupted the professor and said, "You're doing it all wrong. You do not read the scriptures. You must sing them." And the professor invited her to stand, and in a voice that filled the entire auditorium with beautiful melody, she sang the Quran. And it was one of those transformative moments when the full beauty of another tradition washes upon you and you understand that this is something extraordinary.
I'm glad we're all here today and having an opportunity to have this discussion before you so you can get an idea and a sense of the relationship that Martin and I have developed over the years and an appreciation for each other. As I mentioned earlier, this church has meaning for our family, and we're very happy to be here again today, especially on a cold day like this. I know Bonnie said when she came in this morning that she wasn't sure she could play, she was so cold, and I saw her later hugging her mug. I'm not sure what was in the mug, but I'm assuming it was warm. And although Bonnie is a mug hugger, I don't drink coffee, but I do drink tea. So I find myself, I've become a tea hugger, because in the morning, and rather than a tree hugger, because I like the feeling of that warmth on my hands as I start the day. So I'm assuming that's what Bonnie was doing this morning, warming her hands. We've had an opportunity to participate in a number of events together. And some of them have been marked with joy, and some of them have been marked with sadness. And excuse me, if I get emotional, I have a neurological problem, and it can cause tears to come up suddenly, and they're uncontrollable, so I apologize. We have stood together at various times, and other members of our Interfaith Association have too. I can remember at one time my husband was quite ill and was in the hospital and didn't know anything that was happening around him. He had leukemia, and they had thought that he was developing melanoma also because it's a comorbidity. They oftentimes happen together. And so he was in surgery to get a biopsy of a large lymph node in his chest. And Rabbi Marks came and sat with us, and Reverend Julie Blythe, who is a Presbyterian pastor and my best friend, came and sat with us as well. And he led us in prayer. And it was beautiful to know that we had people praying together, Christian, Jew, Muslim. The Baha'i Temple in Evanston, if you've ever been there, was holding a special prayer service for him. There were people literally all over the world that were praying for him, of all different kinds of faiths. Even the Hindu temple, there were people there here in Springfield that were praying for him. Although the doctor came out later and gave us the bad news that it was melanoma, the next morning the same doctor came back into the room and said, "I can't explain this. The biopsy was very clear that it was melanoma. We repeated it though, and there's no sign of melanoma." Power of prayer in our lives, at least, from our personal experience. There were other times when we've, as a group, attended weddings of members of our congregation. We've had developed some, even our children and grandchildren have developed some unique relationships with various people within the Interfaith Association. Our grandson, when he was a tiny tot, used to accompany me to the board meetings and I can for the Interfaith Association. I can still remember seeing him on the floor with Rabbi Datz and the rest of us sitting around the table trying to conduct the meeting. And the two of them were on the floor using a spoon to shoot sugar packets across the room. Unfortunately, one of them hit Rabbi Mark square in the forehead just as he was making an important point. I don't know if you remember that one or not, but that's one of the things that happened. Our grandson, when he was about 4.5 years old on a Friday night, we were heading home, and he says, wait, and I said, "What?" And he said, "We have to go to temple." I don't know how he had learned, but somehow he had picked up the fact that Jews worship on Friday nights. And he said, "We have to go to temple." And I said, "Well, what are we going to do at temple?" And he said, "I'm going to say hello to my two favorite rabbis." And later went to the mosque at Friday prayer and announced that he had been with his two favorite rabbis. So those kinds of things happen as a result of association.
I think that we would both agree that it's been a mixed bag occasionally. There was a time, it's true. There is a high school here in town that every other year invites myself and a priest, a rabbi, and representatives of different faith traditions to come during their World Religions Week. And I actually was just invited for February, so I will return. And so I will go and I will do a presentation presenting this faith to a group of high school students. Some of them, especially those who are LGBTQ, perk up and they realize there is a safe place for them in the larger Springfield community. But many of them are closeted because it's not safe to come out in high school, let alone with their families. But I've had some individuals attend service here afterwards, sometimes years afterwards, and recall my words. And then they cautioned me that the minute that I and the other faith leaders would leave the room, the teachers would then lecture their students about why we were all wrong, probably going to hell, and don't believe a word that we had just told them. And yet, because there are some individuals who have responded and come here, I continue to put myself in those front lines. On another occasion, after 9/11, you may recall that in many cities there was a surge of interfaith activity and certain songs, "We Would Be One," were lifted up and sung together and people held hands. And it reminded me of the time in seminary when I was completing clinical pastoral education in a hospital with a crew of about seven seminarians representing each one a different faith tradition. We're at the end of an intense 3-month period of being with each other, processing life and death moments of patients, and being by the bedside of people in horrible pain, that it seemed for an instant that if only we could just hold hands and sing Kumbaya, we could sing away the world's problems. But then there are other incidents and times when we realize that sometimes the walls that people erect around their faith traditions are meant to keep others out, and it's very difficult to scale those walls.
when we talk about some bad times, some things that have happened that aren't necessarily examples of interfaith, positive interfaith associations, we think back to 1995 when here in Springfield, Illinois, a group of white supremacists burned our first mosque to the ground. And I can remember getting that phone call early in the morning and thinking, okay, what do I do? What do I do? Pulled on some clothes and we headed for the mosque. I pulled out my cell phone and I called a member of your congregation. And he's not a morning person, trust me. I'm sure Yosh can attest to that. But I called Larry Golden because he was a member of the Coalition to Promote Human Dignity and Diversity, in fact, was one of the founders of it. And I said, this is what's happened, what do we do? And within a half an hour, he had done a fax blast. Yes, we were still using faxes back then. And had sent out a notice to all the media outlets, as all of the law enforcement agencies, and all of the member organizations to let them know what had happened. I started getting phone calls immediately from the media, and they said that was the largest response and quickest response to any incident in Springfield they had ever seen. And it was because people of all faiths came together in response. That day was the same day that we had the Interfaith Monthly Meeting, and I can still remember five congregations offering their places of worship until we could rebuild. And we developed incredible friendships and relationships that have lasted us until this year.
Maryam and I have had the unique, I'll call it privilege, of serving as president of the Greater Springfield Interfaith Association. And we have both seen as part of our charge to go and do outreach to different faith communities and to invite more people into this mix. And one of the culminations, the crown jewel of a given year, is when we have our interfaith Thanksgiving service. And over these past decade or so, I've been the chief liturgist. And we joke in UU circles about how the minister's job is really to herd cats. But I must tell you, bringing together representatives of a dozen or two dozen faith traditions and getting them to limit their remarks to 3 minutes each and to do things in proper sequence and to showcase something beautiful and lovely from each tradition and to get it to work like clockwork in the space of an hour and a half, that is truly herding cats.
And sometimes the claws come out. We have also had things, amazing responses to other incidents here in Springfield. In 2001, when we had the horrible events take place, the congregations in Springfield immediately supported our community, fearful that there could be some retaliation, and came and rallied around us. We have seen that time and again over the years, and in response to that, we have, as an Islamic community, tried to be sensitive to the needs and issues of other congregations as well, no matter what has gone on. Shortly after the burning, I think it was the same year or maybe a year or two later, after the burning of our mosque, the stained glass windows in Temple Israel were broken out three consecutive weekends in a row. And so our congregation decided they needed to show support for the Jewish community. So I asked Rabbi Marks if we could attend, and he said, by all means. We ended up outnumbering the members of the Jewish congregation that evening. It was a wonderful thing because I saw people go through the doors of the synagogue that I never would have thought would step foot in a Jewish house of worship. And that was a true conversion experience, in my estimation.
The two of us share a particular personal theology that I liken to call incarnational theology. That there are the words that we say and the thoughts that we think, but what really proves your faith is how you live and how you act in the world when you are side by side. And one of the things which we have done, both in the context of the interfaith community and GSIA and just in our houses of worship, is to break bread together. And I think that that's very important, that people can serve a meal, whether it was iftar, many of you were able to join, or the meals following the Habitat for Humanity work that we did twice together. There was the House of Abraham and the House of Shalom, that members of this congregation worked side by side with Jewish and Muslim and Protestant and Catholic volunteers, building something from the ground up, and then taking time to break bread and to get to know each other one-on-one at a very personal, rich level. And that's where, as we say, God is in the relationships. And that's where something special happens, in those moments of silence, of eating, of sharing together.
And although we've had two interfaith builds so far, the third one will happen this summer. And I hope that your congregation will check with the Habitat for Humanity on their schedule for that, and I hope that you'll become involved, because I know they'll need lots of hands to get that up. And it is a wonderful relational opportunity. I can still remember the first one we did, the House of Abraham, and my husband and I drove up one morning, and there was Rabbi Marks and Dr. Tamizadine, who is a kidney specialist here in Springfield, hanging siding on the front of the house. And my husband's first thought was, couldn't they have put them on the back? Well, I don't know that either one of them had ever held a hammer, but there they were. And it's interesting, the siding is still standing, and so is the relationship that the two of them developed, because they've become very close friends.
One of the more poignant interfaith experiences that I have had in this city of ours was being invited to be to participate in the Holocaust Remembrance Service. And I've actually done that twice now. And so it meets at the Old State Capitol, and there's a whole ritual and a whole series of people offering their remarks, and then the keynote is by a Holocaust survivor. And then the candles to remember the Shoah and the millions slaughtered during that era is performed. And then a person such as I, and Maryam is more recently, is offered to give a closing benediction. And in that hour, in that space, especially after you've heard about the awful experiences of a survivor, and being reminded of all those who did not survive, and being asked to lift up a message of hope and reconciliation for the larger community, is a very powerful, unique experience.
I've talked a little bit so far about relationships and how the Islamic community has developed relationships with other congregations over the years. And I will say that I don't know how many of you know that the first house of worship that Muslims had in Springfield was actually the First Presbyterian Church. We used to use the basement of the First Presbyterian Church as our place of worship on Fridays and for holidays as well. And I can remember one holiday, our children were still in grade school at the time, and the 4th of July fell during the same weekend as we were celebrating the end of Ramadan, the fasting month. So we had had our potluck breakfast and the gifts to the children and our whole program. And as we left, there was a parade going down 7th Street. Our children were so excited and started saying, "Mom, Dad, look, they threw a parade for us." It was only when they got older that they realized the parade wasn't for them. sure where you want to go.
One of my favorite, well, you had mentioned location, and I would remind people that one of the early meeting places for the Unitarian Society of Springfield was the Temple Brit Shalom. And for many of us, we have the opportunity to go there on Christmas Day for the Interfaith Breakfast. Yes. And the first time I went there, and I stood in line, and they were serving sausage, I did a double take, because certain things should not happen. But of course, the levity of the situation, and again, sitting down, breaking bread, often with strangers, who by the end of a meal are no longer alien or strange unto you, but have become, been drawn into your circle of friendship. As we gathered this week, Maryam and I, to discuss this service and what we might say, we did a lot of brainstorming, enough to fill pages and pages and hours of amazing conversation. But we understand the limitations of this space and time. And so the most important thing that we came to an agreement upon, I believe, is that the common thread, regardless of the spiritual, religious pathway a person walks when they, in our collaborations, interfaith collaborations, we have determined that the common thread, the most important asset of any individual, whether it's a lay person or a faith leader, is the essence of love. And I shared a comment that was written by a Universalist minister 200 years ago, which Berkeley Moore later turned into a song. We do not have to think alike to love alike. And you have experienced through the Parliament of World's Religions and through all many different interactions and friendships, just a breath of love, which is just extraordinarily deep and profound.
Yes, this last November, I had the honor to travel to Toronto to be a part of the Parliament of World Religions. And it was an amazing experience. Nearly 8,000 people were there from all over the world. And some of you may know a minister that had been at the United Methodist Church, Sarah Isbell. And she was my traveling companion and roommate for the week. And it was like we were in college again, because we would lay awake at night from our separate beds talking about all the events and all the things that we had seen, trying to absorb as much as we could. And I think it was a transformative experience for both of us. Although she had been to the Parliament before in Utah, this was my first opportunity to attend the Parliament. And to see people truly respected, no matter what their faith tradition was, and being given voice and an opportunity to speak about their love for each other. And no matter what their traditions, that was amazing. One of the things I'm still left with is that every day the Sikh community fed all 8,000 people free of charge. And it was hard to imagine the organization that took by their volunteers from their community to do this. And we appreciated that so much, because it gave everyone, as Martin said, the opportunity to sit down and break bread and commune with one another, not just through what we were eating, but what we were saying to one another and the love that we could demonstrate. And the projects and things that came out of those kinds of conversations and the relationships that will, I believe, will continue for years to come. Where one person says, you know, something needs to be done about this, and somebody else says, I'm interested in that too. How can we work together? And you develop that kind of appreciation that love is greater than the name of any one religion. It transcends that. And that we can use that love to begin to develop better relationships, to address the world's problems, as we see the need to do so. And one of the big ones that we were addressing while we were there were issues around climate change. That was one of the major focuses of the parliament this year. So I really, and also issue around women, issues around indigenous peoples. It was fascinating to see all of these issues being addressed in constructive ways without any rancor.
In my opening words of this presentation, I mentioned, or I quoted Dr. Seuss, "Oh, the places you will go." Some of you, perhaps many of you, are aware that Maryam and her family will be moving to Florida in the spring. And so we hope and we trust that the seeds of faith and love and compassion which you've planted here will continue to flower with each new season, and that you will find ample opportunity to plant additional seeds in your new home.
Thank you.
Thank you for
much.
Joining us.
Thank you.
For our closing words, I also return to Mary Oliver, who has three poems represented in our gray hymnal. And this is number 696. "To live in this world, you must be able to do three things: to love what is mortal, to hold it against your bones, knowing that your own life depends upon it, and when the time comes, to let it go, to let it go." Amen and blessed be.
For the postal event, I'm going to do a gospel song in honor of Martin Luther King's birthday, and I'm going to mix a couple of songs about love in there too.